The impact of the world economy and changes in regulatory laws have left companies exposed. This candid conversation with attorney Stuart Grant, managing director of one of the leading global corporate and securities litigation firms, discusses key issues and market trends facing today's institutional investors.
I'm looking forward to the opportunity to address the CFO Forum on my trip to Israel. I will be speaking about recent trends in mergers and acquisitions in the United States, as well as recent trends in securities laws. I think that this hopefully should be of interest to my friends and colleagues in Israel. One, because I think that what happens in the United States, just generally on an academic level, may be well followed in Israel, but almost more important, with the United States having such close economic ties with Israel, that events that occur there in the United States invariably are going to affect the Israeli economy and decisions that Israeli businessmakers and investors are going to face. And so I hope that if I can provide a little bit of insight, that you all may be able to take away something from my talk that will cause you to look at what you're doing maybe a little bit differently. To be a good shareholder these days, one has to be very aware of what's going on. And you don't want to wake up one morning and find out that your company has suffered a billion-plus-dollar loss because the government has come in and fined them, or shut down a plant because of problems, or that a failure to disclose certain risks, which can come about in the business, but wasn't disclosed to investors, now results in huge potential liability. And so one of the things that is important to understand is trying to recover damages for losses that occur is not the best way to enhance your performance as an investor. The best way is to prevent losses from occurring, because almost never will you be able to recover 100% of what you've lost. And so to be an active shareholder, to be involved in the corporation, to take action when there's something wrong, to send a message to all the other portfolio companies that you've invested in, is very important to move the process along so that it is protective of shareholder value. So that's why you want to become involved. Now, you may have to become involved so that you can recover losses that you've suffered, but I think most people believe that fixing the system in a way that losses don't occur is really the ultimate goal. And, you know, I joke with my clients that my real goal as a professional is to eliminate my profession, and that if we could eliminate greed and wrongdoing, then I'm out of a job, but I'm very happy in doing that. So my clients want me to retire soon by fixing the system where they don't have to worry about fraud, they don't have to worry about conflicted transactions, they don't have to worry about any of these problems that we see now. So I'm often asked the question from CEOs of banks, of brokerage houses, of other types of financial institutions, why should I be concerned about this? And the reason is because your shareholders are concerned. And those who invest money with you understand that sometimes investments don't work out. But they want to know if they've been had, if there's not been something that happened in the economy or business just didn't work, but somebody really did something to cause damage to them. The folks who invest want to know, what are you doing to protect me? Are you just kind of taking this and sweeping it under the rug and thinking that, well, maybe no one will notice? Or are you saying, look, if somebody, you know, intentionally wrongs me, then I'm going to do what I can to protect you and to protect your investments? And it shows the kind of care that you as a CEO put into your company when you value what's happening to your shareholders' money and treat it as you treat your own. And I think that that is the kind of ethos and corporate ethics that shareholders want to see, to give them a comfort level that, you know, their money is well taken care of. Well, executive compensation, particularly in the United States, has become more and more of an issue. And with the passage of Dodd-Frank and with advisory votes now on compensation, we're actually catching up to the UK and other European countries who've had shareholders have far more input into executive compensation than maybe we have. But often executive compensation is a reflection of a company's values. And many investors now look at compensation as a reflection of performance. And by what that I mean is just a large executive compensation package in and of itself doesn't tell you a lot. But when there's pay for non-performance, a corporation's stock continues to drop, a corporation's future seems bleak, and yet the CEO pay continues to rise, that's usually an indication of significant problems. You know, if the CEO of Apple is well compensated, I think people think, wow, that's well deserved. Look how that stock has flown. Look at the innovation that's taken place there. So I think investors are not concerned with the aggregate of executive compensation, but I think have become more concerned and certainly more and more active regarding tying compensation to performance. I do think that, especially with folks outside the United States, that there is a misunderstanding about class action and collective actions, and that they believe that, you know, everything having to do with either securities law or corporate law is a class action. Now, there are some advantages to investors for class actions, and that is that if you want, you can sit back and do nothing and benefit from a class action because it's brought on behalf of everyone. But more and more, the courts are cutting down on class actions in the United States. Interestingly enough, at the same time, Europe is looking at expanding the ability to bring class actions. But the sophisticated investor understands that a class action is a tool in the toolbox, but that there are many other tools. And many of our clients are bringing individual actions because they realize that bringing an individual action can be easier and can be far more profitable to them in the size of the recovery that they get. And we're finding more and more large institutional clients are going the route of individual actions as opposed to class actions. And one of the other interesting things is that we are finding more of our clients willing to bring actions outside the United States, and particularly in Europe, who has become more receptive. Now you may say, well, what is a U.S. attorney worrying about actions outside the United States? Well, our clients have turned to us and say, you understand how to manage securities litigation, corporate litigation. We'd like you to almost function as our general counsel to go out and retain counsel in other countries, particularly in Europe, to be able to find out ways to finance the litigation so that when European countries who don't have contingent fees, which are fees that relate on the outcome, that we're still not out of pocket and that you can find other ways of financing this, that you can use the tools that you may have in the United States to gather evidence and the investigation and forensic accountants to help put the case together for the European attorneys who are going to bring it forward. And you can look over their shoulder because many are not experienced, as are the courts in those countries, in handling securities actions or corporation types of actions. And we provide that service. So we're finding that those who understand that there is a toolbox with a wide variety of tools, which can mean U.S. litigation, it can mean European litigation, it can mean class action, it can mean individual action, it can be sitting down and just negotiating with no action with companies or with potential wrongdoers, that those are the folks who can both make the portfolio-wide changes to change behavior as well as obtain the recoveries that they need when someone is at fault and they've been wronged. Grant Eisenhofer provides information to clients and helps the clients work through the decision tree to make smart decisions with regard to their investments. And I say that because sometimes our clients come to us and they say, something's wrong here. We have, you know, we've suffered a huge loss in one of our portfolio companies. We're not sure exactly what happened. Can you find out? And we're able to investigate those claims. If there are accounting issues, we can bring that expertise. If there are other specific industry issues, we can gather that information, synthesize it, and present it to our clients. So what's on the horizon over the next 6 months? I think the two big issues, one is old and one is new. I think the new one is the LIBOR price-fixing scandal, which clearly has stretched worldwide. Because we have tens of trillion dollars of debt, which is priced in terms of LIBOR. Everything from mortgages to loans to corporations to bonds. Because of all of this, the LIBOR price-fixing scandal is going to be incredibly broad, and I think it's going to be around for maybe a decade. Lots of people who've issued bonds, who've been on the receiving end, have been damaged, cities and towns, countries, and I think you will see ramifications throughout the financial system as this is sorted out. I think the other thing is somewhat left over from the last financial crisis, which is the mortgage mess. And U.S. banks are still working their way through the mortgage mess, but that mortgage mess has gone beyond mortgages because, of course, these mortgages were securitized, and many entities are sitting there holding different tranches of CDOs, CBOs, CLOs, the whole alphabet soup. And these collateralized debt obligations are located in portfolios throughout the world. And we're still working our way through that of how do you value these to the extent there was wrongdoing, who is responsible for it, who was damaged by it, what happens if you had some of this and you repackaged it in something else without realizing how toxic these things were, what is your responsibility? And that has certainly gone viral throughout the world. And so I think those are the two big challenges facing the financial institutions throughout the world are the mortgage mess created primarily in the United States and collateralized throughout the world, and the LIBOR price-fixing scandal, which is certainly centered in London but has reverberated throughout the world. At Grant Eisenhofer, we represent primarily institutional investors, whether those be banks, insurance companies, mutual funds, retirement systems, family offices, or very wealthy individuals, but the folks who provide the money to keep a capitalism running. And what we do for them is they may contact us, or some of them have us monitor their portfolios by having their custodian send to us daily reports electronically so that we know what they have. And we keep an eye out for what's going on that could affect their portfolio. But of course, they keep an eye out also. And if something happens, either a large stock price drop in one of their companies or some kind of corporate transaction or difficulty within the company, we are alerted to it either by our portfolio monitoring system or by our clients themselves who call us. And the first thing we do is gather information. We have the ability and relationship with experts who can take a look at financial statements, who have accounting expertise, who have industry expertise. And what we do is collect all the data and succinctly put it into a report so that our clients first have the facts, what's going on here. Then we work with our clients to say, well, what redress is available, if any, to address these problems. And we walk through that and lay out the issues and the potential resolutions of those issues. And we show our clients, you know, what tools are in the toolbox, and ultimately work with them. And if they decide that they want to bring legal action, there's a number of ways they can do that, whether it be in the United States or potentially Europe in certain situations, whether it be through class action, individual action, or some kind of smaller group action in which a number of our institutional clients get together and bring some kind of lawsuit that way. And that's how we work with them. Sometimes we also work with them with regard to shareholder proposals, to be able to influence the corporation in advance of a problem and try to avoid problems, try to get better corporate governance. So those are the kinds of things that we do for our clients. And those are the ways we do it, the information flowing both ways, either from our clients to us or the ability for us to monitor their portfolio and send them information to say, you should be aware this happened with one of the companies that you're invested in. So when I came to Israel last year, I know I was asked, why are you coming from the United States to Israel? We're a small economy. Why should you expand your business here, and why should we think about it? And the answer is that Israel's not so small. That the sophistication in the financial community here, the amount of money that's invested, is significant. And foreign investment in the United States is significant. And we represent a number of funds in countries that are comparable size or a little bit larger. We represent Scandinavian countries and sovereign wealth funds there. We represent the largest pension funds in Holland. We represent a number of funds throughout Europe. And they have all found it both to their economic advantage, as well as fulfilling their duty to their either retirees or investors to understand the U.S. markets more and to participate not only on the investment side, but if something goes wrong on the recovery side. And Israel is a place, first of all, where I know that you're not afraid of conflict, that you have views and that you're willing to express them. Also, I know that you don't take when someone wrongs you lightly. And so the economic size and sophistication and personality of the country is such that I think that this can be a very nice shidduch between Grant Eisenhofer and the Israeli investment community.